Hey folks, before we get started, I just want to let you know about my upcoming book, The Max Coder's Guide to Finding Your Dream Developer Job. If you're looking for a job or you think you might be looking for a job in the future and you're trying to up your mobility and meet new people and things like that, this book walks you through the whole process. Go ahead and check it out. It comes out on November 20th. It'll be on Amazon and you can find it as The Max Coder's Guide to Finding Your Dream Developer Job.
This episode of the DevEd podcast is produced by Thinkster.io. With the rapid pace of change to front-end and back-end frameworks alike, staying up to date with your skills can be tough, but it doesn't have to be. With our expert-led courses on Thinkster.io, you have instant access to hundreds of courses on topics ranging from Angular, React, and Vue to Python, Rails, Docker, and a whole lot more. You can even customize your learning path to include any combination of front-end and back-end technologies that are relevant to you. Thinkster.io, a better way to learn.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's episode of the DevEd podcast. My name is Brooke Avery, and I'll be your host today. On the panel today, we have Sam Juline.
Hey, everyone.
We have Mike Dane.
Hey, what's up, everyone?
And Preston Lamb.
Hey, everybody.
And then as a special guest today, we have David Graham, who is the CEO of Code Ninjas. So, David, thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, definitely. Now, we always like to start by having you kind of introduce yourself, give us a background of how you got into development and, you know, kind of your journey of where you are today.
Well, that's a long story. I don't know how long this podcast is supposed to be, but I was a software developer basically from 6 years old. And that sounds like a ridiculous statement, but my sister was 7 years older than me. She got a computer for Christmas and threw it in a corner. It was a Commodore VIC 20. I picked it up. And I've been coding ever since, just the way it rolled. It was something I took to naturally. Professionally, I was, you know, my first contracts were when I was 17, 18 years old. I was building oil and gas applications downwell for Anadarko metric tracking stuff and just all kinds of application development there. And then I got fortunate enough to be able to be a .NET beta tester when that rolled around in the like 99, 2000 era. And so I went through the original tests for .NET 1 and basically stayed in a C-sharp .NET realm for my entire, let's say, 15-year career. Then I went into business, and that's my development path. I stopped developing at some point and just started working in the businesses. So
very cool. Okay, so then now currently you're working with Code Ninjas.
That's right.
And tell us more about that. I've seen a number of these locations popping up around town, like Preston here. We're both kind of close to each other near Salt Lake City area, but I've seen a number of these popping up. So tell us more about Code Ninjas, what it is, and a little bit about the mission.
Yeah, so Code Ninjas was the spinoff company of my former company, kind of, because we were teaching adults how to code. We were number four to market with the coding bootcamp craze. You know, there's a ton of them out there now, over 300 or so, I think, are still in existence. But we were the fourth one on the market seven or eight years ago now. And that went really well for a long time. We loved it, but not a week went by while we were running that company. Somebody say, you know what, I'd love my kid to come in on the weekends and just learn a little bit about code. He's like sitting on Minecraft or whatever. And I just love for him to be using his screen time more effectively. And so that's really got me to start and thinking about how can we take away the screen time idea and make it brain time and still keep it kind of fun. My son happened to be in Taekwondo at the time. You know, I sit there 2 hours every single week watching him do kicks and stuff. I have no idea what he's doing, but watching him build up, and we have these milestones, and I see him getting happier and happier. And I said, and at the time, we had a 9-week program, and they had 9 belts on the wall. And I thought, well, you know, we could make every week a different belt. And I was like, adults really don't dig it. But if we ever did a kids program like these people have been begging me to do, well, I got something there. Like, we could kind of make a play on the two things. And then I thought, you know, there's an old expression in the programming world called code ninjas. I kind of borrowed that expression that was, you know, ubiquitous with somebody that knew how to code really well. And then later on, after we sold that company, which eventually became part of Steve Wozniak's education firm, we moved almost directly. Like any good entrepreneur, I took 2 weeks off and got my head together and started another company almost immediately, and that was Code Ninjas, using this basic premise. And when we came to the market space, there was already people kind of doing this after-school program, teaching kids how to code, but nobody was doing it in a way that I thought would get keep kids engaged. And that was a fun first mentality, because I know little about kids, but what I do know is if they have fun doing it, they want to do it more. And so I wanted them to be, this is the one after-school activity where they can feel like they have their place, they are learning something, but they also feel like they're having fun doing it. And so I knew if we struck all those chords, we would really have something special. That original kind of premise and idea has been validated almost 200 times over now with open centers in the U.S. and Canada. We're now also selling into the U.K. and actively opening. We have about 150 other centers in development right now. So by the end of next year, we feel like we'll be 350 strong across the globe. And that was 3 short years ago.
Wow, that's awesome. That's a lot of growth really quickly. But I think it shows, you know, how much people are wanting this and how much people are really craving these kinds of, not just after school, but I think just in general, people are wanting really good education for programming and coding. So looks like you guys have really hit on what people are wanting. But we were talking a little bit before we started recording, and you were explaining about how Code Ninjas has three different programs. So kind of speak about that and let us know what each of the programs are, how you do that.
Yeah, sure. So when we started, what one of the things I told all of our franchisees, let's make sure we do 7 to 14-year-olds amazingly well. Let's bring a world-class product. And above everything else, let's make sure the experience is right. And when we get all of that right, and that whole pricing and everything is perfect, then we'll become the area, the community coding center, right? Everybody will think of us as the place to go learn to code. And we can do whatever we want. We can add on younger people and older people. And so after the first couple of years, we really fine-tuned our program. We really made it into a fun experience, not just a curriculum. And kids absolutely love it. So it was natural when kids are sitting in the lobby playing with our Legos and our building blocks that we call the Ninja Toolkit. You know, but they just aged out at 4, 5, and 6 years old. They couldn't come into the program. Well, we had to create a program for them. And so what we did was we went to, and it's called Code Ninjas Junior. We went to CodeSpark, which is the largest non-reading educational software in the world, with more people using it every single day than anyone. And we said, let's set up an exclusive partnership. Let's leverage our facilities and our ability to get in front of more kids than anyone. And you're obviously great ability to build curriculum and for these non-reading ages and combine those two. And so they were on board. Actually, they'll be here in just a few minutes. We're about to have a big kind of celebration party. Our pilot just went off and it's going like gangbusters, man. The 45 or so different facilities really love the Good Ninjas Junior program. We're about to roll it out nationally. I think all of our centers should be picking it up in December. So very successful rollout for that program so far. Very happy with the outcomes. And the kids are loving it, more importantly. The other side of the coin was we get a lot of parents coming to us and saying, you know, I'm just a hobbyist programmer. I'm a lawyer. I just like to be able to put up a website. I got this idea for an app kind of thing. I just like to learn some kind of coding. I don't want to be a software developer. Not trying to get these guys out of jobs or anything. But I just want to know a little bit about what that world is. And so what we did was we kind of learned some cues, and that program we built is called Code Ninjas Pro, which will be released early next year. What we did was we took some cues from language building sites. Have you ever done like a Duolingo or something like that, where it's kind of passive learning, where, you know, you could have your spouses in the kitchen, your kids are running around the house, the news is on after work, and you might want to spend 10 to 15 minutes of kind of passively getting answers right and wrong, but learning the answer no matter whether you got it right or wrong. That's a little bit less aggressive than my old way of learning, which was the boot camp style. But then at the end of that track, every module, you'll come into one of our centers, sit down with a qualified person, and learn how to put that knowledge that you just learned to work. And so you'll do a lab that is on the track that you chose. So if you said, I want to build a website for my business, well, you're going to build the first step of that track there in the center with your senseis. So that's for 12 and up. So now we've kind of always got somebody in the family. Everybody in the family can always attend the Code Ninjas and learn something.
I love that. I love a lot of things that you said there, especially that what you're doing is you're getting students learning by doing, and they're actually applying the skills that you teach them, and they're building something. And you were comparing that to kind of that passive learning. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I went to school for computer science, and about 10% of it was actually applicable to the real life world. And those 10% that was applicable was actually building applications. Most of that occurred after school. I was hanging out with what I call my Fantastic Five, my five best friends that were nerds like me, and we just get together and crank out some code. That was when I learned the most. And so kind of making that little learning incubator inside our dojo is what we're trying to hope for.
Nice. So kind of going along with that, though, what I want to talk about for a minute is kind of the current state of education for programming and coding in the K through 12 system.
Specifically the public education system?
Yeah, well, and it could be private as well, I suppose, but mostly public. And this is really open for all of our panelists. Like, as you guys have gone through school yourselves, or you might have children who are going through school, but do you feel like the school system is adequately teaching students how to be programmers and developers? And what do you think needs to be done to kind of supplement that, I guess?
So I can jump in for just a minute. I don't think currently, at least from what I've seen, that it's being adequately taught in public schools, but I don't think it's because people don't want to teach it correctly. I just think that there's some more training and some more learning on for teachers that has to be done. So about a year ago, I went up to the local high school. I graduated from there, and my wife coaches volleyball, and we still live close by. So I'm pretty invested in that high school. And I reached out and said, hey, if you have any computer programming classes that I could come visit, I'd love to do that. And I'd love to come talk to the students. And when I spoke with the teachers of those classes, they had very, very little experience in programming at all. They were trying to learn the curriculum that they were teaching kind of as they were going along, and they were doing their best. But one of the teachers said he did a little bit of programming when he was in college 35 years ago or something like that. And obviously things have changed drastically since then. And so I think that it's a great goal to have. I know Utah has a goal to have computer science classes in every class in every school in the state in the next handful of years. And I think that's a great goal, but I'm not exactly sure that just having the goal and getting the classes there is enough. I'm not sure what the next step is as well, but having the classes is great. And that's a good way to get people or get the kids at least introduced to what programming is. But I think there's still some stuff lacking there.
I think one of the big problems, and specifically with computer programming, is that curriculum tends to get outdated pretty quickly. So, every couple of years, there's a new popular language, there's new frameworks, there's new methodologies, there's new technologies that people are programming on. And so unlike something like math or history or basic science, like that never change, computer programming is constantly changing. And it is difficult, especially if you're not an expert, to be able to navigate that and to be able to figure out, okay, what should we actually be teaching? What are the important things to be teaching? So I think developing the curriculum in that environment, unlike an environment that's like a private boot camp or something, can be a little bit more difficult just because of the nature of the field.
Mike, you make a good point. I think when you say that technology is always changing, I think that's pretty much on everybody's mind. Every year we get a new iPhone, and developers know a new framework comes out, annually for basically everything we've ever done. If you'd asked me how to build a program for kids 10 years ago, though, somebody would have inevitably brought up Ruby on Rails. Today, it would be almost unheard of to start a program on Ruby on Rails. So what I think we have to do as educators is think about what's the purpose, what's the point. And the point is to get kids to think like a programmer, not to memorize what's in a book. And that's kind of a broader topic on education, but getting people to learn how to think and solve problems is what the core of being a great programmer is. I always break it down into these steps: isolate the problem, break it down into the multiple parts, distribute those parts amongst your team, and then work in between your team members to deliver a superior product. No matter what you do in life, programming, medicine, building a building, that's the same problem-solving skill set. And so if we can drill that into kids' heads and use coding as a catalyst for that, I think they're better off in the long run than just picking the specific flavor of the week technology that's out there.
So let's speak about that a little bit more then. How do you get kids excited? Maybe they don't know very much about programming. They're not really sure what it is. How do you get kids excited and eager to learn these kinds of technologies?
Would you like to build your own video game?
So you entice.
Yeah. I know people can't see my head shaking, but they always say yes. Yes. That's pretty much every response we ever get. And then that's the lead in, right? And we say, well, you know, building your own video game means you work on a team. And so you need to start thinking right now about building a team of people that you can work with, that you guys love video games together, the same kind of game, and y'all want to build one at the same time together. You know, and you do it in a more playful environment than saying, you know, we're project, you know, going to do a Scrum project or whatever. You know, that's not fun to kids. And that's the way we think, but that's not fun to kids. But we talk to them at their level. We talk to them at the play level. Does that make sense?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else?
I don't know much about this area. One, because I don't have kids. And two, it was a long time ago that I was in high school or elementary school. So I can't imagine my experience is relevant. But I watched an amazing talk at NG Vikings this year. Jeff Welpley and his daughter Maddie talked about Maddie's journey to learning to code. I think she's like 8 or 9. And it's really interesting because he basically worked out this process of starting with like really sort of what he calls subliminal messaging about programming, and then working through like online games, and then using something like Scratch, and walking her all the way through until she was like actually writing code. And it was really fascinating. I'll link the talk because it's very relevant to this topic.
So do you feel
we often say we Jedi mind trick them into learning to code because they don't know they're getting educated. You know, they just feel like they're having fun.
Yeah, exactly. Like what you're saying. Yeah, that's sort of what they did, is like walked her through this whole process until, you know, somewhere in the middle, then she started realizing she was actually programming. And that's when they started teaching her like syntax and stuff like that. This real seamless transition from just like playing a game to then like, you know, using something like, I think he used Blockly, where you can like drag and drop like sort of a UI for simple programming and stuff. It was really cool.
So then along those lines, you just named a couple of them, but are there certain programs that you guys all would recommend or use with, you know, younger children or middle-aged children? But what are some of those programs that you would use to help them to learn the basics and make that transition, like Sam was explaining?
I don't know a lot of them, but I have a 7-year-old daughter who's been playing on code.org, and she's had fun with that. It's like a lot of the times that when I've been watching her, it's like she has this little character and there's a whole bunch of squares on the board, and she has to drag and drop the instructions to make the person go forward one square. And then maybe there's a repeat loop if it's going to go forward 3 times or whatever, and then turn right. Obviously that's not like, you know, sitting down and writing a for loop and writing this code, but it's getting her thinking about how do I solve this problem. And so I think that's been helpful. There's probably other ones, but that's the one that we've used, or my daughter's used at our house.
Obviously, I will plug Code Ninjas in this regard. We have a custom built platform and a custom built curriculum and development tools for just doing this exact thing. But if you're looking for something that you can learn at home, I think the Hour of Code is what Preston was just talking about on code.org. They have a lot more materials, but that's a nice introduction to see if your kid even likes it. I mean, there are, believe it or not, a certain subset of kids that just don't get into it, and that's fine. And then if you get kind of lost and need some help, there are plenty of great resources from the Scratch people, for example, on how to take the next steps past block learning and things like that.
When I was a teacher, I used to let my kids play on Code Combat was what it was. And that one was really neat. I think I've spoken about it before on the podcast, but the idea is that you go, it's almost Zelda-like, where you have to, like old school Zelda, where you go through these very, you know, like maze-like lands, but you have to program it so that you're telling your character how to get through that maze. But there's also challenges, like the bad guys will come in onto the screen and you have to think enough in advance to get your character to avoid the, you know, the bad guys who are kind of moving around. So that one is really fun. I really like Code Combat. Any other thoughts there?
So I have a thought again on how we can get kids interested in programming. So I think anytime that you can, well, help them be successful in some way and show them that programming is not as hard as they may think. Because I remember a few years before I really got into some development classes and stuff, I was talking with somebody and they told me, oh, you should check out computer programming. And I was like, oh, no, I'm not smart enough to do that stuff. I don't understand how all that works and how computers work. And I can't do that. I'm not smart enough for that. And then I ended up trying it and I realized, okay, there are some parts that I'm probably still not smart enough for, but there are things that I can do and I can learn how to do it. And one of the things that helped was one of my classes, we built just a simple HTML page with just HTML and CSS. And then we put it on a server at the school and you could go to a URL in your browser and actually hit this website. And that was cool to say, oh, okay, like I now have a website somewhere on the internet that I can go to. And so helping kids do simple things at first where they can see the results of their work and go to it on their parents' phone or on the computer or whatever, I think giving them those little wins will help them to be, help them want to continue to learn and to continue on with it.
I like that. That was another thing that was always really important in the classroom was finding ways to make the curriculum relatable to the students. The more that you could always pull in interests from your students and connect that with what you were teaching, the more buy-in that your students had. And it was so much easier to keep them engaged and excited about learning. But I don't think that that really is different for adult learners either. So how does this relate to adult learning? You know, this idea of having, and you've already said, David, you know, you have this Code Ninjas Pro that you're about to launch for adult learners, but what are some of the similarities and differences that you've noticed for children and adult learners as you've, you know, gone through your career and been teaching learners of all different ages how to program?
If I told you, if all six of us sat down and wrote a list of how to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, you know, that list is going to be pretty darn close to each other. It might have some nuance in there. You might have to go up in the cupboard and I might put more detail about what bread to pick up. But pretty much that's going to be the same list. And that's what programming at its core is. That there's not a lot of nuance. It's only one way to kind of do it, especially when you're talking about fundamentals. Let's put it that way. Fundamentals don't change. I mean, it's a while loop. It's a while loop. It has a conditional and it has a body. So how do we approach that? I think what is similar between that problem set and between kids and adults is the preconceived notions, kind of what Preston was tapping into there, where we nerds have had it going good for a long time. We've convinced the rest of the world what we've been doing is miraculous. It's kind of like Scotty on the Enterprise. You never saw him go like, no, this is an easy problem to solve. Let's just, you know, no problem. He's always, you know, I just can't do it, Captain, kind of thing. And that's what coders have done for a long time. It's impossible, but I'll get it done by Friday. What that leads to is people think you got to be really smart to do this. And I think we're proving that everybody can do it, smart and, you know, middle intelligence and everything else. And so getting over those preconceived notions, I think, is a big part of it, no matter their age range. Another one of those preconceived notions, other than just general intelligence, is that you have to be good at math. I was a professional developer for 20 years almost, you know, still a pretty good hobbyist. And I was never really great at math. I took it and I did well, but I was never like a math guy. And so what happened for a long time is only people who were good at math went into programming. So it was almost like a self-fulfilling prophecy that you'd only get the math nerds being programmers, because everybody thought that you had to be a math nerd to be a programmer. It was just a weird thing. So you got to break down those barriers as early as possible. And I think that's the same for kids and adults. Making people realize that you can do it too, you know?
That's basically what happened to me, David, was I had always wanted to be a programmer. And when I got to college, I started in computer science and they're like, cool, here's Calc 2, and next semester you'll do Calc 3, and then next semester you'll do differential equations.
And linear algebra just for fun. You know?
Yeah, and I was like, I just want to write code. And that turned me off because I was like, well, I guess I'll never be a programmer because I'm okay at things like calculus, but I'm not great at it. And so I just gave up and decided to go do something else because I figured, well, I don't want to take all this math in order to be a programmer. And then it was years later that I realized, like, oh, you actually don't need to know that stuff.
That's true.
One ambition I had early on in my career was actually to build iOS apps. And so, of course, my solution was to start a podcast talking about how to build iOS apps. And so we asked around, we got some ideas, and eventually Josh Susser from the Ruby Rogues podcast put up the idea of the iFreaks show, and that's what we called it. You can find it at ifreakshow.com, and every week we're talking about iOS development and Swift and Objective-C and libraries and reactive programming and all of the things that go into making good iOS apps. I don't run the show anymore, but we've got Andrew Madsen, who puts together the curriculum for Lambda School. We've got James Uber, who's been doing iOS development as a freelancer for a long time. We've got Mike Holt, who's a good friend of mine, who's worked in Xamarin and in Swift, and currently does a bunch of interesting work on that. And we've got other people that we're bringing in all the time to make that show better. So if you're trying to keep up on all of the advancements that Apple makes, all of the announcements from WWDC, and you want to hear from people who are doing this day in and day out and talking about it and teaching people about it and doing the work with it, then you definitely need to check out iFreaks. You can find it at ifreaksshow.com. That's I-P-H-R-E-A-K-S show.com.
I talked a little bit earlier about how there's probably some deficiencies in the way that programming is taught in public schools. And I was speaking more about high schools and elementaries and stuff, but I think there are some in higher education as well that at least when, you know, I graduated with a computer science degree from Utah State, and the emphases that they had there were, you know, pretty limited, and they were very heavy in math and science. And right now, I believe it's still this way, but at Utah State, if you want to graduate with a computer science degree, I don't think they have a web development emphasis yet. But last I checked, you had to have 1 year of chemistry or 1 year of physics. You had to take Calc 1 and Calc 2 and discrete math, which the discrete math one wasn't as bad when I took it. But there's a lot of math and science when, you know, I sit down and I code all day and I build these websites for people. Not once have I ever pulled up a calculus equation to put into one of my websites.
You're not balancing chemical equations either, right?
Yeah, yep. I don't need to know about physics or chemistry. Now, some people might need to know about physics and chemistry as computer scientists, but I think we could do better at schools in having a broader range of topics and ways to become, you know, developers and not have to go through science when you're not going to use it, or math when you're not going to use
it. Yeah, I think what you're doing here is very important. You're talking about becoming a computer theorist scientist as opposed to a computer programmer. And like, I get there's a time and a place for everything. I think there is a time and a place for a person to have a broader education, especially in their, you know, freshman, sophomore year, just out of high school. You probably don't know who you're going to be when you grow up. So you probably do need a little more exposure to some broader topics in the world. But that does not help you become a better programmer necessarily. And that was my whole business for 4 years. You know, we capitalized on that centralized theory that, you know, let's focus on the good stuff, the doing and not the theory. You know, how many times I've used a bubble sort in my entire career? Like maybe once, and that was just on a lark, but I learned in every single programming class, right? So like every language, you got to learn how to do the bubble sort again. You know, what learn how to implement generics again. Well, you know what? I've done that in three different languages now. Can we just move on? So some even within the practice of teaching computer science, in those computer science classes, they needed to do a lot of work to get it from a theoretical education to a practical doing scenario. And so
it's interesting. It kind of makes me think, I feel very strongly that something that high schools should be doing more of, I don't think exclusively, but I think high schools should be allowing more opportunities for kind of like an apprenticeship. And to me, it seems like development is one of the perfect fields for that, because really, and it's exactly what we've been saying this whole time here, is that there really isn't a way to learn how to program unless you're getting in there and actually typing things out and moving things around. But I feel like what we're all saying is that focusing just on theory and concepts isn't going to cut it. And so a lot of what these programs should be focusing on is finding opportunities where students can actually go job shadow, or like I said, do some kind of apprenticeship where they're really, you know, getting an opportunity to practice those skills. And I wouldn't see any reason why they couldn't eventually partner somehow with like a Code Ninjas, where you guys are helping to provide that education, so that it may not be at an actual business or company, but kind of in that more workshop environment. I don't know. I think that'd be a pretty interesting idea to see that happening with schools.
Yeah, I think that'd be a great idea because, like I said, when I was at the high school near my house last year, I 100% believe the teachers were doing the very best they could, but it's hard for them when they're already a full-time teacher. Now they're chosen to teach this computer programming class and they have to learn it and it's not their full-time job and stuff. And so that can be hard. So partnering in some way with a private company that does have full-time teachers that are just trying to teach children or high school students or whatever, how to code, then everybody can do what they're, you know, what they're trained to do, and they can do it better if they've been trained to do that.
So here's a question for you. It's like Sam said, you know, Sam saying, I don't have kids, neither do I. I think Mike, I don't think you have children either. So why should we care? You know, why is this a big deal? Why is it something that we're talking about educating younger generations? Why should an everyday web developer care about educating youth?
I think when the computers take over and they are our evil overlords, we're all going to need to know how to communicate with them. That's the biggest reason, you know, and those kids are going to be at a fault if they can't. I mean, that's a joke, but it's kind of true, too. I mean, as automation progresses, you have to look at the bigger picture, and those kids are going to grow up to adults. By 2035, something like 40% of the jobs that these kids are going to have don't even exist today. There's not even a title for such a job. That's because things are moving in such a fast-paced direction. And so if you want to just be myopic and think about your own situation, I don't have kids, why do I care? That's okay. But I think most people, if they think it through logically, know that the economies of the world are built on top of education. You don't progress in a society without proper educating your kids. And that means we got to prepare them for those jobs that don't exist. Simple as that.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the problems in the future, like the solutions are going to come at least partially from software. So software is involved in just about everything we do nowadays. And I think it's just going to become more and more a part of it. And so the more people, the more citizens that we have, especially in this country, that are literate in programming, at least in some sense, or able to write code, those are the people that are going to be creating the next big apps and the next big problem solvers. So I think it's a good bet to invest that time and money into teaching people how to code, because that's the language of the future. That's the language of innovation.
You know, on an ancillary note, it changes the way you think, irrespective of programming. Like the whole problem isolation and development cycle. I can't tell you how many times I've thought like a programmer on things that have nothing to do with programming. I think it's just a really great way to introduce basic logic and reason to kids on a foundational level, which in our hyper-political and unbalanced world that we live in, a little reason can go a long way. And I think that's just good enough reason to do it there.
Absolutely. I agree. So then how? How can, you know, the average developer working at the office building down the street, how can he or she get involved with helping raising this new generation to be at least like what Mike was saying, at least familiar with development, but more than that as well? How can we get involved to help youth really get in and dive into web development? Are there programs that you guys have been involved in, or, you know, what else? Like we know that Code Ninjas is here. That's our top go-to, but what else is out there?
There's plenty of them on top of the local areas too. I mean, those there's plenty of developers that have, you know, little smaller locations that are doing different things and doing it differently than us. I mean, certainly there's an academic approach to this, even with kids. And I think there's a lot of people doing it the right way, if that's what you want. But there's a lot of different nonprofit organizations where you can also donate your time and money. Code Ninjas Cares is our nonprofit arm, which I have nothing to do with, but it does have a mission of getting kids, no matter what their background, into this education system. And we work really hard on finding whatever they need. If they need a ride, if they need a compliment, a pat on the back, a snack, or tuition money, we try to give it to them and get them where they need to be. And I firmly believe that there's no ladder to success that's better than an education, and specifically in technology, out of poverty into upper middle class America. So if you want to become involved, I would recommend finding a great nonprofit that you can work with. Sometimes they're looking for teachers. Sometimes they're just looking for money. Sometimes they're looking for help with building a curriculum. But all of those programs, there's code.org is a great one. I think that's been mentioned here a couple of times. They're more of a big grant type where they don't do a lot of boots on the ground type work. So it might be harder to get involved and donate your time there. But find out who they're donating money to and granting those funds to and become involved at the local level. Go to your library instead of a coding branch there. I mean, they'll let you do it, I promise.
There's an organization I worked with in the past called Girls Who Code, and they run like summer camps and after-school programs specifically targeted at like middle school and high school girls, which I think specifically is like a hugely underrepresented population, just women in coding in general. So yeah, I'll plug that one. Girls Who Code, it's a nonprofit, and they just, yeah, they do like camps and stuff.
Something that I really like, you know, Joe helps. Well, Joe is one of the organizers for NG Conf, and I've been able to help out with that quite a bit. And one thing that I really loved is that while the conference is going on, they actually put on a little side program, I guess you could call it a side workshop or conference specifically for children, and they call it NG Kids. So that's really neat, because if you're already going to the conference, then you can just sign your kid up to be there while you're there and take your child with you, and they go and they do their own age-appropriate, level-appropriate little program with other children around their age. So, you know, I definitely agree. You kind of have to do some exploring. You might have to ask around a little bit, but like David was saying, you know, ask around at the library. But I think if you just do a little bit of exploring, you can find programs that I think a lot of people just don't know about. But they're out there. They exist. And that's like the one Mike was saying, NG Girls. But definitely just do some basic research. Like here in Utah, there's one that I want to say it's Ken Garf. He's a local car dealer, but he has started a program for coding. And they do it now over the summer. But they offer free, basically like a camp, you know, a position at a camp where these high school age kids get to go in and they learn how to, I think they've been focusing on like Ruby or something. I can't remember the language or the framework that they've specifically been learning, but they do have a set curriculum and they, you know, they teach them that, but it's expanding every year. And I think if you just kind of ask around and do some searching, you can find programs like that in your community, in your area. And then, yeah, you either get your own children involved in it or you yourself can go volunteer at them. But those kinds of opportunities are great and they're out there. You just need to go find them. All right. So then the next question I have would be, we've talked about a few of the opportunities that are out there. We know Code Ninjas is there, but is there anything that you wish existed that currently doesn't, for not just children and youth, but even for adult learners? Is there any kind of training that you just think is lacking right now and that we should fill this hole, this need?
I kind of wish it was easier to get exposed to more real life code bases. It seems like really the only way that you can, you know, experience like the real workflow of being in a company and doing like CI stuff and, you know, writing tests and going through that whole development process is like actually getting a job. So if you, you know, for developers who kind of already understand the basics, I think it'd be really cool if companies allowed you to come in and, you know, maybe like do an actual PR on a code base that's not open source, that's kind of within a company and kind of go through that whole workflow. Because I think, especially for me, when I first got into the industry, you know, I got my first job, that was one of the most intimidating things. And one of the things that I wasn't prepared for was just kind of the realistic day-to-day processes of being a software developer. So I think, you know, as good as it is to have this like training material and, you know, kind of be sheltered from that, I think that the sooner that you can get in and start doing real work at a real company, I think the better. So I wish there was kind of a better way to do that without having to actually like work for a company.
Brooke has mentioned this. She mentioned it today and she actually mentioned it on another podcast as well, but finding or like an easier way for people to shadow developers to see if that's actually something you want to do. Well, it's easier if somebody knows, like my little brother could call me and say, hey, can I come sit with you for a day? And, you know, I work at home and he could come sit next to me and we could work. But it'd be kind of nice if there was a way for people, whether they're high school students or adults or whoever, to kind of sign up for a day with a developer and go to meetings with them and sit down and they could see what a day is actually like and see if they could sit at a computer for 8 hours. And just a lot of times, probably, at least for me, I probably work in isolation 5 to 6 hours a day. And then the other couple hours, I'm, you know, maybe talking with some coworkers or whatever. So I think giving them a way to see what it actually is like, because people hear of all the benefits of being a developer, and those are all true. They're all great. I love them. But it is tough sometimes to get up the energy to walk downstairs knowing that I'm going to sit at the computer for the next 8 hours and just type away by myself.
You know, there's a lot of meetups that people do around. I see, you know, even here in our valley, we have, oh God, I don't know, 10 or so meetups where any developer can just go and they have, you know, they'll have little talks and workshop sessions. But I think it would be really neat to see one for younger generations as well. So kind of what you were saying before, David, but specifically like making it a meetup type group even. And then advertising it in those same forums. Like I think, what is it, meetups.com or whatever. But if people were making it, putting it out there just the same way that you would let adults know that there's this group that's getting together, but do that for children as well and high school age kids.
So that's really similar to what Jeff Welpley started in his area. I think he lives near Boston. He started something called NG Club, and it was started with him and his daughters and then people from their school and stuff. I'll add a link to that as well. But yeah, that's a great idea. And it sounds like they've gotten some good traction with that.
That's awesome. So then how can it benefit us? You know, we've talked about how you can go and volunteer and help these younger people, but what benefit does that give us as everyday developers?
I think uniquely, it gives you an in-depth understanding of the things that you do every day better than you ever would have had you not taught it. It's the first time you ever stand in front of a group and you teach it to someone else, you better be on your A game, because they're going to think of like 90 things that you've never even pretended to think of. And, you know, maybe 45 of them make no sense, but the others, you have to really know it thoroughly inside and out, or they're going to call your bluff basically and lose faith in your ability to educate them. It's okay to say, I don't know, let's look that up. How would you find that answer and all that kind of stuff? But as educators, it's the reward is twofold. I think you get a better understanding, a more comprehensive understanding, and you get the benefit of seeing a life made better for it. I mean, it's kind of selfish in that way, that you get the warm and fuzzies every time you see, you know, the aha moment for a kid or an adult even learning something new that they can apply to their life.
Kind of like fine-tuning your skills. It's not just going through the motions, but really learning the in-depth ins and outs of what you're doing and the why you're doing
it. There's a lot of power in that why question. And there's a lot of answers that can come from that, just simply asking, why do you do it that way?
Yeah.
I don't know. This is the way I was taught to do it. That's not a really great answer. So why do we do it this way? And it makes you kind of second guess your routines. You know, you plow in the same row for so long and doing it the same way so many years, maybe I need to address why I'm doing it the way I'm doing it. Maybe there are new ways to do this. And it makes you reevaluate constantly as you educate.
Any last thoughts from anybody there? Okay, then, so David, I have one more question for you, and that's just, does Code Ninjas ever allow, or do you need volunteers ever, or do you feel like, you know, your hired employees are all that you need?
So we're a franchise, so I obviously at the corporate office, and so we don't hire the teachers directly. That would be through our franchisees. However, our nonprofit, Code Ninjas Cares, is always looking for volunteers that want to hold sessions. We get a lot of underprivileged school districts that maybe can't afford to throw camps or don't have a way to do it except through volunteerism. And so we're always looking for educated people on the topic, especially educators who know about programming to help fulfill some of the needs in the inner cities and things like that. So that would be a great way to volunteer your time if that's what you'd like to do.
Great. So just contact the local franchise.
You could certainly work within their locations, but if you want to work and volunteer your time, probably go to codeninjascares.org. Yeah, that's our nonprofit. And just send them a message and let them know that you're up for a challenge and to help out.
Great. Okay.
Back when we were starting up new shows, one of the shows that got started was Views on View. And one of the things that was really fun about that is that I got to know a bunch of really terrific people in the Vue community. And furthermore, one thing that happened that really hadn't happened on any of the other shows, we actually got a member of the core team to come on as a regular panelist on the show. We have Chris Fritz on there. The other thing is you may recognize some of the other voices. Ben Hong, who's on the official Vue News podcast, is also a panelist on the show. He's worked for Politico and now works for GitLab. We also have a bunch of other terrific panelists that come on and talk to you about what's going on in the Vue community. And because they're so closely tied to Vue and they talk to people about Vue all the time, they're very up-to-date and very knowledgeable about what's going on in the Vue community. So if you're looking for a way to learn Vue.js, or if you're looking for a way to stay current with Vue.js and kind of have the water cooler conversations you wish you could have about it in places where maybe they're not using it, then definitely check it out. You can find it at viewsonview.com.
What we do to kind of wrap up the show, we always like to do a favorite share. So this is just something that if you had a best friend that didn't already know about something that you've just totally been loving lately, like a favorite book or a movie, a favorite website or application, just whatever, we like to go around and share what that favorite thing is. So does anybody have one they want to start with today?
I just got a new Bluetooth speaker. It's called the JBL Clip 3. It's like super small. It clips onto like a backpack. It's really good. So I'll drop the link into the chat.
I'm a Wheel of Time fan, if you didn't see by the sign behind me. And they're coming out with a new, they're filming the new episodes for Amazon Prime for that series. And I'm really stoked about that right now. So I'm in all the fandom and nerddom around Wheel of Time.
So yesterday I saw a list of all the movies and TV shows and stuff that's going to be coming out on Disney Plus, and I felt like I was taking a step back into my childhood. So I'm excited for that to open up next month. So that's what I would tell anyone that likes all those Disney Channel original movies and stuff like that. They have lots of other stuff too, but that's what I'm excited for right now.
I'm with you on that, Preston. I think it'll be fun to have all those movies kind of at our fingertips. And now that Disney's acquired so many other companies, it'll include the movies from those other companies. So it'll be neat to have all of that in one place.
Not to mention all 30 seasons of The Simpsons.
There you go.
I have a browser, a web browser. It's called Brave. Give it a try. It's got some good security defaults for your browsing. So I've been moving my browsing day to day to Brave browser. Give it a try.
Pretty cool. That's actually my nickname, so I'll have to check that out. So I have one just to kind of go along with today's theme with our topic. But back at Christmas, my 12-year-old niece was really excited because she got this Harry Potter coding kit. And it's like a wand that you build the wand, and then using the app that comes with it, you learn how to code. And so you have to like go through all of these coding exercises with your Harry Potter wand. And you use your iPad, I think it is, it makes, you know, it lets you do magic. So you have to actually go and perform the correct coding principles, and then your spells and things get cast properly. So if you have a child who likes Harry Potter and wants to get into coding, I think that's a great product to use. And it's the Harry Potter Cano Coding Kit. So I'll put that in the show notes. Is that everybody?
I didn't go, but I feel like between Disney Plus, Brave, and Amazon Prime, I just feel like everything's been covered. Plus, I'm still addicted to Breath of the Wild, so I don't really have anything new to add.
It's been taking all your time.
It's basically eaten all of my free time, which is dumb because I have so much work to do.
Oh, that's funny. Okay, so
Breath of Wild 2 is coming out, though, so there's that. You'll have that to look forward to.
So I got
to
finish quickly.
Well, all right. Well, thanks, everybody, for joining us today and for listening. And again, thank you to David for coming with us. And everybody, check out Code Ninjas. There should be a local franchise somewhere in your area. So go check it out. And yeah, thanks again.
And I wanted to say real quick, I'm always available to entrepreneurs or technologists that just want some advice or help or just ear to bounce something off on. You can find me on Original. I'm at Original Coder on Twitter. So just come find me.
Great. All right. Thanks, everybody.
Yep. See you guys.
See ya.
Bye.
Bandwidth for this segment is provided by CacheFly, the world's fastest CDN. Deliver your content fast with CacheFly. Visit CacheFly.com to learn more.